first lesson comes from the book of Lamentations, the third chapter, verses 22 through 33. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in truth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. Here ends our first lesson. Our gospel lesson for today comes from the gospel according to St. Mark, the fifth chapter, verses 21 through 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Greetings, sisters and brothers in Christ. The title of our message for this weekend is from today's Gospel. Do not fear, only believe. Let us pray. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So when my children were young, one of our favorite family films was a film called The Never-Ending Story. And it was a movie about a little boy named Elliot who was really struggling because his beloved mother had just died, and he was deeply grieving. And he lived with a father who had just shut down himself in grief. So home was very difficult. To make matters worse, every day as Elliot would walk to school, the bullies, the mean kids, would steal his lunch money and beat him up and throw him in the dumpster and just bully him horribly. And he was, each and every day of his life, terribly afraid to even walk to school. One day when the bullies were chasing him, he ran into a store, and it was an old used bookstore. And this elderly man who owned it kind of had a good sense of what was going on, and he told Elliot that he had a special book for him, and he takes out this ancient volume with a big seal on the front, and he says to Elliot, "Watch out for this story, because you're going to be asked to enter into the story." So Elliot takes this book and hides out in the attic of his school so the bullies won't find him. In the middle of the storm, he reads this story, the never-ending story. It's a story of a different world, a beautiful, amazing world, but a world that was on the brink of being destroyed because of evil forces. And so there was a little princess at the final climactic scene of the film, and she says to Elliot, "You have to be part of the solution. You have to save the world, and you have to do that by giving me a new name." And Elliot doesn't believe that the status of the whole world depends on him. So he at first refuses to do this. He hesitates, but then this little girl is crying and she said, "Please, Elliot, please, you have the power to save me and to save the world. All you need to do is to give me a new name." And at last he cries out the name Mariah, the name of his mother. And that turns the tides, and this world, this earth, begins to restore and replenish itself and come back to life. And Elliot has been part of the changing, the transformation of the world. Well, today's gospel, in fact, every Bible story, invites us to enter the story. And when we enter a biblical story, it expects a response from us. We are to literally enter the story with our lives, and we're to cast our lot on one side of the story or the other. Are we to be part of the solution by joining in with God and all the people of God in bringing about a new and transformed world? Or are we going to just say, "Oh, this doesn't have anything to do with me. I'm not going to enter this story," and in a sense, be on the side of those who are bringing about the destruction of the world? So the story within a story, today's gospel. Now remember, last week we left off with Jesus getting into a boat, exhausted, with his disciples. He's been healing, preaching, teaching, doing miracles, and he says to his disciples, let us go across to the other side. And he wanted to take them away for a time set apart for prayer and contemplation and to be with his Father, with God in heaven. But when they get to the other side, the crowd has followed them and, in fact, arrived before them. And there's such a huge crowd of people in great need, and they're all pressing in on Jesus. Nevertheless, we're told, Jesus had compassion for the crowd. And among those people in the crowd is the synagogue leader, a man named Jairus. And Jairus comes before Jesus, and he falls on his knees at Jesus' feet, and he begs Jesus to come to his home because his little daughter, who we later learn is 12 years old, his daughter is at the point of death. But he feels that if Jesus could come and lay hands on her and pray for her, Jesus could save the life of his daughter. Jesus, of course, always casts his lot on the side of saying yes to working with God, his Father, to bring about healing and transformation and a new world and new life for all he encounters. So Jesus heads off with Jairus. But as they're on their way, the crowds are pressing in on him, and Jesus feels someone touch him. He feels power go forth from himself. And when we get to this part, it's the story within the story. So the bigger story is Jesus heading with Jairus, the synagogue leader, to heal his 12-year-old daughter. But within that story, as Jesus is on his way to do that, a woman who's been hemorrhaging for 12 years comes beside him, and she has such deep faith that she prays that if only she is able to touch the hem of his garment, she knows she will be healed. And so Jesus feels this power go forth from him, and he says, "Who touched me?" And his disciples say, "Jesus, look at the crowds. Everyone's touching you. What do you mean, who's touching me?" And he knew that power had gone forth from him to heal someone. And I think he even knew who she was, but he wanted to give her the opportunity to step forward. So this woman, we were told, with fear and trembling, comes forward again, falls at his feet, and explains that she is the one. She tells Jesus that she knew that if she just were able to touch the hem of his garment, she would be healed. Jesus says to her, I love this, he says, "Woman, daughter," he calls her actually, "daughter, your faith has made you well. Your faith has healed you. Go in peace, be healed of your disease." And as this woman is rejoicing, servants of Jairus come along, and we're taken back to the first story of his little 12-year-old daughter at the point of death. The servants come and say, "Jairus, don't bother the teacher anymore. Your daughter just died." Now we can imagine the heavy heart, the total despair of this Jewish leader, this synagogue leader, Jairus. And Jesus looks at him and he says, "Jairus," he says, "do not fear, only believe. Do not fear, only believe." And so Jairus too must have had incredible faith, because he continued on the journey with Jesus despite what his servants said. So right now, I want you to enter this never-ending story. And I want you to think about the fears in your own life. Elliot, the little boy, had his fears of those bullies, his fears and sadness and deep grief of losing his mother, his fears of his father ever healing from his grief. Jairus had his fears for his daughter, and especially when the servants told him that she had already died, filled with fear, gripped with fear. And the woman also, the hemorrhaging woman, great fear, fear to even enter the crowd, because women who were bleeding were considered unclean, and so were not allowed to even be near other people for fear of the bleeding women touching others and making them unclean. But this woman dared to go among all these people who had ostracized her. She had lived for 12 years, not only struggling with this hemorrhaging, this illness that made her weak and fatigued, but also with the social isolation and being ostracized by others because of her illness. She, we're told, was filled with fear and trembling. And we too have great fears. This day, bring to mind your fears. What are they? And I even invite you to just write them down if you can. I identified my own, and I've also been talking with people this week about their own fears. And I would say fear number one for myself and for many is the fear of the destruction of our planet. This amazing, precious planet, this gift of God, this beautiful earth which God has entrusted to our care, and the way we have destroyed it through the choices we've made and the ways we've lived. This reminds me so much of the first reading from the Book of Lamentations. Lamentations was for a long time attributed to the prophet Jeremiah, and it probably wasn't he himself who wrote it, but they put his name on it because he preached to the people of Israel in the southern kingdom of Judah. The northern kingdom of Israel, the 10 tribes of the north, had already been conquered, and only the southern two tribes, Judah and Benjamin, were holding on. And they were a bit cocky, saying, God will never let us be destroyed because we have the holy city, Jerusalem, in our midst. But the prophet Jeremiah and all the other prophets kept preaching and pleading with the people to change their ways, to turn back to the ways of God, or they would bring dire results upon themselves. They would suffer the consequences of their actions, just as we today, who have abused the gift of this precious earth, we'll suffer the consequences of our actions as well unless we change our ways. So Jeremiah and the other prophets pleaded with the people of the southern kingdom to change their ways, but they did not. And lo and behold, in 586 BCE, Jerusalem was conquered by their enemies, the Babylonians. Hated enemies, feared enemies. And the temple was leveled, it was destroyed, and all of their holy objects were carried off as booty of war. Still to this day, Jews remember and have an annual day of lament, remembering the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem in 586 BC. And then after years in exile, they rebuilt and it was destroyed again by the Romans in 70 AD. And so they gather still today for a year of, every year for a day of lament. But also to remind themselves to heed the words of the prophets so that they don't continue to bring destruction upon themselves. And we too today, more than 90% of scientists tell us that if we continue on the path we're on, we will destroy our earth. And yet many do not even believe in climate change. The prophets, like the young Swedish girl, Greta Thunberg, we need to hear their voices and change our ways. We need to, like Eliot, risk to step on the side of being part of the transformation of this world and not just sitting around criticizing. The second great fear I hear from people, and it's connected to the first, is We fear what we might call man's inhumanity to man. We fear violence. We fear crime in our very divided world today. We fear racism and sexism and gun violence and hatred and all of that. We fear, especially for our loved ones being harmed. And this is similar to that fear I feel that Jairus felt for his beloved daughter. We fear for our children and our grandchildren. We fear for our loved ones to live in this world. But Jairus went with Jesus. Jesus said, "Do not fear, only believe." And Jairus continued the journey with Jesus. And Jesus went in and took his little daughter by the hand and raised her up to new life. Did it happen literally? Or is it an image of resurrection, of living eternally with God? I think in this case, it was both. But we too, that is a great fear for our loved ones. And as a mother and a grandmother, I have to constantly hold on to the words that Jesus said to Jairus, "Do not fear, only believe." And then finally, I want to go back to that woman, that fearful woman, filled with fear and trembling. So we fear for our planet, we fear for our loved ones, we also fear for ourselves. Maybe you've been struggling with health issues. We're living in the middle of a global pandemic. Maybe you fear this getting sick with this terrible virus. We fear for ourselves and that we fall into despair. And it's not difficult to do with all that's going on in our world. But the words that Jesus said to that hemorrhaging woman, he says to you and to me this day, "Son, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of whatever dis-ease is keeping you in that grip of fear." Now, healing, the word in Greek means wholeness. It does not always come in the exact form we expect. And I'm always reminded of the Baptist minister, the famous preacher, Tony Campolo, whom I had the pleasure of hearing preach. And he told a true story that one time he went out with the healing prayer team from his Baptist church, and they prayed for a man who was battling cancer, that he would be healed. This was the first time Tony Campolo had gone out with the healing prayer team, and a few weeks later, he gets a call from the wife of this man, and she tells him that her husband has died. And his first thought was, "Oh man, I stink at healing prayer, because I prayed with everyone one time for this ill man and he dies." But as he kept silent and listened to the conversation, the woman went on to say to him, "I cannot thank you enough for coming and praying for the healing of my husband. And he indeed was healed." Now remember, healing means made whole. She said, "You know, he had cancer, yes, but the deeper illness was my husband was a mean and vengeful person with a hardened heart. And he had treated me horribly and all of our children. And he left all of us with this litter of broken relationships. And when you came and prayed for his healing, wholeness, he was transformed. He became a new person. He mended his relationship with me and with all of our children. He asked our forgiveness. He told us he loved us. He was healed, made whole. Thanks be to God. So, sisters and brothers in Christ, this day, may we, like Elliot, may we, like Jairus, may we, like that hemorrhaging woman, may we dare to enter the story of today's gospel, the never-ending story. And may we, who, if we're truthful, are also sometimes crippled with fear, may we hear the words of Jesus said to us this day, "Do not fear, only believe, have faith." And God, who is faithful, will bring about transformation, new life, healing, wholeness, for great is God's faithfulness. Amen.
Please.
And now may God bless us and keep us. May God's face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May God look upon us with blessing and grant us peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve God and the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.